stuff. One shot at a time.
You're right, Roy. Just knock it on. Let her rip.
That's what you play golf today.
No, I'm not, Grandpa. I'm playing tennis.
You're playing golf and you're going to like it.
Just go home. That's your home. Are you too good for your home? Answer me.
Welcome to the Out the Bunker podcast with DT and Jase.
What's crack-a-lackin', home slices and home slicettes? This is Top Deck Golf, your boy Jase and my boy DT, aka Daniel Thomas. Together we are Top Deck Golf, the 2023 World Amateur Match Race World Champions, and just a bunch of cool dudes. Welcome to the pilot episode. This is our first podcast recording for Top Deck Golf. So today we're going to go through a couple of subjects. You guys are going to find out who we are, what we did to get into golf, a little bit of our background, and we're just going to kick it off from there, just have a nice little chat and some conversations with you guys. So welcome to the pod.
Well, first of all, you want to tell them what we call the pod?
Yeah, Out the Bunker.
Why do we call it Out the Bunker?
That's pretty much where I spend the majority of my time, whether I'm playing golf or not. What you guys will know about me at the end of this show is I'm also homeless. So I sleep in sand traps quite a lot.
It's not a laughing matter, man.
I didn't laugh.
I did. I shouldn't be laughing, right?
No, it's called Out the Bunker. You know, we might be world champions and you guys might hate us because you ain't us, but that's besides the point. We're just two average golfers, I guess, who happen to stumble across a game that we love playing, something that's kind of rekindled a friendship for us as well. And for the average Joe, we'd probably spend the majority of the time in their bunkers as well, depending on where you're playing. So That's kind of how we came up with it, I guess.
And look, I guess the biggest thing I get asked all the time from our socials and things like that is like, how the hell did you guys ever get started in this? And I guess I kind of want to just give a background as to where we were. I can still remember the day. I was like, dude, let's catch up. Let's have a drink. Let's hang out. We started playing golf again. And we were kind of sitting down at your apartment.
Mm-hmm.
We were watching just some episodes of YouTube golf.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, we were like, dude, these guys are way too good, man. Like, no one plays golf like this. 1% of the world, or 1.something% of the world, shoot well under par.
Like, has their type of handicap.
So we're sitting there going, okay, these dudes are giving all this information. None of us can play this shot.
Yeah.
So
I mean, we think we can.
we tell ourselves
we can.
So what the hell are we watching this for? So we thought, what a great little niche, like showing people the average golfer.
Yeah.
You know, like I'm on a 11 to 13, depending on the day, depending on where we're using the handicap.
Yeah,
you're on whatever
like
you're on.
I usually range from like plus 4 to minus 20.
Yeah, 100%,
yeah.
Right? So it can range from anywhere. So all of a sudden we were sitting down and then we started talking about Seinfeld. We somehow got onto Seinfeld, and there's that one clip, and I'm going to play it here in a second. There's that one clip that just sold everything to me. We were sitting down drinking Gentleman Jacks, and you had me wetting my pants, and I was like, you know what? This is something that I could mess with. Like, I could hang out with you, playing golf, laugh, and having a good time. And since then, that's all we've done.
Yeah, pretty much.
Right? I don't know.
There's a bit of anger in there, but that comes down to my level of game, not anything else.
Before I play the clip, can you give me a little bit of a snippet of, I guess, the show, the scene where Kramer comes in talking about golf?
I mean, so anybody who's watching or listening to this, if you've never seen Seinfeld before, Kramer's like their extroverted character. He's a bit of a nut job, but he comes in and he's got this brand new set of clubs and he wants the boys to come down to the beach and hit golf balls into the ocean. I guess like any of us would want to, just to kill time. And then I guess a couple of cutscenes later, he comes back and like any average golfer who thinks they're going to play like Tiger Woods in the morning, we finish our round of 18 and we come back and we absolutely hate the game. So, and it's never our fault either. He blames the clubs like I've blamed my clubs or the equipment before too. So
look, I'm just going to play a little clip. You can have a watch, all right? And for the viewers at home, they'll get to see this in real time. But let's just have a look here. This makes...
$600.
You know how
much? Yeah, so many golf balls.
Dude, 12 golf balls.
Yeah. Well, he puts it in his boot, I think.
Into the ocean.
We find a nice sweet spot between the dunes. We take out our drivers, we tee up, and the ball goes sailing up into the sky.
You got it.
There for a moment, and then.
The sheer disgust on George's face. Oh, yeah. Like, he's like, this sucks, like, man. I ain't doing this shit.
Why,
like,
do I let this man in my life?
I'm not doing it. And then they show the scene of him going out hitting golf balls. He doesn't hit a one. Yeah. Except one.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, the one.
This is when he comes back in, and this is where you had me, and hopefully I've got the clip somewhere that we can play, where I am uncontrollably wheezing because I can't catch my breath. That. Right?
Hey, you want these? I don't want them. What? I stink! I can't play! The ball is just sitting there, Jerry, and I can't hit it. I only hit one really good ball that went way out there.
Well, what happened?
I have no concentration.
Right, so that there sold me on doing this thing with you, all right?
Thanks, Kramer.
Yeah. So you can thank Kramer for having to hang out with me every Sunday. So look, just I guess on that, you know, we started out at Willetton Senior High School together.
Mm-hmm.
You came in late year 10.
Year 11.
Yep. Yeah, so
Year 11 and 12.
And we kind of lost our way a little bit. I went away to America, played ball over there, then went to Europe. You went and did what?
I did a year of basketball in the States and then just came back to Australia.
Yep.
Yeah.
So you then focused and put all your time and energy into like work and comedy?
No, just work.
Just work?
Yeah, comedy only started when I was 30. So that was from what?
20 years ago?
19, 20, I got back. So for a decade, I just worked.
Yeah.
Came back and just accepted the fact that I wasn't going to college in the States. And it was just like, well, this is my life now.
Yeah, fair enough, right? And then, one day I can remember seeing you and I was just like, dude, you play golf? And you were like, yeah. And I was like, man, that's what? Like, I couldn't believe it.
I can't even remember where that was.
It was
a conversation over Instagram.
It was over Instagram. Yeah. I saw you and, like, we hadn't spoken in ages. And then all of a sudden it just kind of, I guess, grew into something.
Yeah.
It's like true love, first sight, right? Kind of. Come on.
For you, maybe.
But yeah, it was. Like, 100%. I'm for comfortable.
You, maybe.
Hey, I'm comfortable with my sexuality.
Yeah, no, good for you. You should be.
You're gorgeous.
Yeah, I know. Right.
So, look, I guess for me, my perspective, I've been playing golf since I was about 7, very casually with my dad, right? My dad used to take me out with a 7-iron and a putter. That was it. I wasn't allowed the big dog.
Yeah.
Right? I wasn't allowed the driver because I'd probably hurt people.
Mm-hmm.
All right. When did you first kind of get into golf?
I got into it with dad again. When I was maybe 13, I remember he took me down to Embleton Golf Course. He was just having around with his mates, and I remember looking at it going, I could do that. Like, just at 13 years old, I was so confident that I could swing just
everyone
as good as they could.
Just do it, right?
And weirdly enough, I mean, I would have played like absolute trash. I wouldn't have been able to hit the ball well at all, but that was a wicked way for me and my dad to bond. We'd go out every Saturday. I'd just tag along with him and hit random clubs every now and then, and like you, didn't really take it seriously at all. Until I was probably, I don't know, maybe into my 30s. I was just, you kind of gradually get the gist of things, but I never really took it seriously or thought I could make anything of it. It was a wicked way to hang out with mates on a weekend and kill a day if you needed to. But, yeah, it's probably only become serious for me within the last 5 or 6 years, I reckon.
But it's a weird addiction, right?
Oh, yeah.
Like, everyone you talk to says it's an addiction. And there's a famous singer, I can't remember his name, older dude, rock artist, and he talks about it like
Elvis, Meatloaf.
Could have been
Michael
Meatloaf.
Jackson.
No, it wasn't that. And any of them. They were actually good, right, and didn't wreck
Roy
kids.
Orbison.
Roy Orbison. No.
Just taking shots in the dark.
Just taking shots in the dark.
Prince.
Liza Minnelli.
Could be a dude.
Hey, careful. We're 2024 now, brother. 2024.
Sir, I cannot.
I cannot. But... yeah, it is. It's an addiction. I know when I first got back into it heavily, I was just like, oh, my God, man. Like, this game challenges my mind. And especially when I quit basketball, when I retired from basketball, I needed something competitive, right? Like, I needed something to just keep me going.
Something to push you and challenge you.
Yeah, and the worst part about golf is you can't blame anyone. Like,
you can.
doesn't work like that, though. Like, if I play a bad shot, I can't blame you. And it's vice versa. Like, there are times where you get angry on the golf course and I have to
understatement.
Understatement. But like you, I'll be like, Jase, you're getting in the car and you're like, nah, I'm walking.
I'm walking, bro.
I'm walking.
Don't talk to me.
Like, easiest date ever.
Yeah, I know. So, yeah. Just silence for six hours.
That's it. It's beautiful. Right. But so look, we eventually got back into it and I can still remember the first day we saw the post. Well, I saw the post and I was like, dude, let's join this tournament. Let's do it.
For World Amateur Match Race.
Like, shout out to World Amateur Match Race, by the way. Like, they put on a heck of a thing for us, and we'll talk about it in a little bit of depth.
Twice. With that good.
And we'll talk about that too, right? But when I first asked you about it, it was like a – I'm pretty sure back then it was only like $170 buy-in, and you were like, dude.
I shut it down so quick. It could have been $100, I would have shut it down.
Dude, so quick.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like my money in my back pocket.
Yeah.
I guess even at the time, I was still am very aware of my lack of skill in the game of golf to play at a competitive level for anything. So
look, we ended up joining it. We said, you know what, 170. I somehow talked into it. And then after about the fourth round, pretty sure it was like the fourth round, we were just like, holy shit, man, we can do this. Like, we can win this thing.
Yeah, hand on heart, I didn't take it seriously for.
No way.
Until we probably got past what they referred to as the loser's bracket.
Yeah.
Like, when we were guaranteed at least into the semis, I was okay, we're doing actually pretty well. Like,
yeah.
You know, we had our ups and downs and stuff like that, but, like, as a team, like, I think the saying is nowadays, we ham and egged it.
Yeah, that's what the Yanks were saying.
Yep.
Yeah.
We did really well. And then I actually don't remember any of our last four matches except the last match.
Oh, I remember the last one vividly, man.
I just remember the last three, four holes where we thought we had it in the bag. We took our foot off the pedal and we didn't have it in the bag.
Started sweating, palms are sweating.
And then that second last hole, I shat the bed. And I remember par five, sliced it to the right. You went down the fairway. I tried to punch it out. I couldn't punch it out. You ended up on the green. And I was like, yeah, this is all you.
This is us. That's it. It's done.
If we lose, it's your fault. If we win, it's your fault.
Not the fact that you screwed up shots before.
The win or loss was down to you because I wasn't contributing on that hole whatsoever.
Man.
And then, I just remember watching that putt go in and I was like, oh, damn.
We're going to Dubai.
Oh, we won.
Yeah.
Like, there's still another hole left, but we won.
Yeah, like, we're going to Dubai. It was like we talk about pinch yourself moments. Like,
100%.
I still didn't pinch myself after.
None of it felt real. Like, even afterwards, we played out the last hole. They didn't shake your hand, whatever. But it was, I remember sitting there and it was one of those moments where I felt like I should have felt emotional about it.
Because
you'd have, like, 6-7 months worth of matches because we only played once a month, and then we did start to take it seriously, so it started to mean something.
Yeah.
And then never in a million years would I have thought anything in my life would take me to Dubai, let alone golf.
Sitting
there next to the green, I remember sitting in the cart and they drove off and I was just like, we were just like, bro, we won.
Yeah.
Like, we're going to Dubai.
It was wild.
Sick.
And then, like, I think for me it was more I couldn't connect the emotion, right? So, like, playing basketball, winning championships and stuff like that in the SBL, now the NBL one, shout out to Coach Parsons as well. He told me I had to say that, by the way, otherwise he's going to hurt me.
I appreciate you for the skill, Coach.
Yeah. But I had put so much time and effort into that.
Into basketball.
So when I finally won my first one in 2016, the emotions did come out.
Yeah.
Right? Like, there was a moment there where I just sat there and I could breathe. I didn't cry. Mm. I didn't get that emotional, but I could sit there and breathe and just go, okay, I've done it.
Yeah, the hard work paid off.
It all paid off. Years and years of being called too short, all this type of stuff finally paid off. Whereas with golf, we went into it with zero expectation.
Yeah, and there was no practice.
No practice.
Oh, no, I lie. We did play one
practice round. We played one round.
Before that match.
Yeah. Right.
But that was about it. I think I had maybe two lessons over 7 months.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Well, yeah. I had one.
And shout out to Glenn Paul, my coach, who I haven't seen in forever, so I'm better without you.
But, like, that moment for me, just that's, I think, why I didn't get so emotional because I was just like, I didn't feel like I'd put that much into it yet.
Yeah.
Right.
Also, I wonder if it's also because we had no idea what to expect. Like, yeah, we're going to Dubai.
I still thought it was fake.
But what does that mean? at least when you get to a championship and you win, you're like, okay, cool, now we're going to get the trophy. Done. Now this is it. That's the end of the season. We focus on next year. For us to win that match, it's like, okay, so what now? Like, we know we're going to Dubai, but how does that work? What is Dubai going to be like? I've never been there before. I've seen it on Instagram. And that's about it. I didn't even know they had golf courses over there, to be honest. But that was cool.
It was so hot, right? Like, you don't think,
And then, to get over there, like, I remember calling my family on the way home. And I was like, we won. Like, we're going to Dubai. And even my dad was like, oh, cool.
Yeah.
And it's not because
he
didn't care. But nobody in my life, no one in my universe was like, holy shit, are you kidding? Like, everyone was like, huh? And most of my mates, to be fair, most of my mates, to be fair, were like, and I don't even know if we can swear on this. If we can't, you can beep it out. But most of my mates were like, how the f*** did you win anything? Like, I've seen you play golf.
We can beep it out.
How did you get to win this tournament? I was like, because I'm good.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm better than you.
And your name.
Actually, that's where the saying, where my stupid tagline.
Well, that's off.
Like, here at Top Deck Golf, we're better than you.
And we know. Well, that's off Dodgeball, right? That's off Dodgeball.
Oh, Globo Gym.
Yeah, Globo Gym. Here at Globo Gym, we're better than you. And we know it.
Yeah.
Yeah, like that. That's where it came from.
Yeah, if that whole process was just to get to where, I think even the day of flying to Dubai, I was like, cool. Like, I'm just going to the airport. I don't know. I couldn't even remember the last time I'd been overseas.
Yeah, me.
Outside of Bali.
2018 was my last time out.
That would have probably been similar to maybe a little bit more recent than
that. Let's be real. Do you consider Bali now overseas anymore, or is it just part of Rockingham?
I never have.
It's just part of Rockingham, right? Yeah. That's where everyone goes.
Yeah, I never had. But, like, I guess I was a travel agent, so I'd been overseas for that sort of stuff. But nothing.
Oh, okay.
Nothing as like a holiday. Bougie. Yeah, dude. Are you seeing me? Okay. But nothing for like a, for anything that holds that kind of weight to it.
No, no way.
Yeah. Certainly nothing that is started by World. You know, like World Amateur Mattress. Like,
Fremantle. Yeah.
The local Bayswater Classic came fourth.
I still have
the scratch and sniff sticker on my fridge.
And then, look, I guess from there, we went over. We did our business over there. We played some amazing golf courses, world-class golf courses that Rory McIlroy.
Best in Dubai.
Yeah, that Rory McIlroy. I mean, you have his tattoo. Well, you don't have his tattoo now. But you will be.
Yeah,
like, our second time that we went, and we'll get into that. Our second time we went, you got his autograph on your shot.
On my bicep.
On your bicep.
Yep, on this bad boy.
On that one? Yeah, so look at that.
I don't know if the camera can zoom out or not, if you can fit it in the screen. But
man, this is what I deal with.
No steroids.
Yeah. You're clean like John Cena, eh?
Yeah.
John Cena.
Yeah, John Cena.
Yeah. But anyway, so we got over there. We played some amazing courses. We played with two Americans that were just top-notch Yanks, man. Like, they were such good dudes to play with.
2 days in a row we got
two days
too.
In
that
a row,
cool.
Man. And that's Joey Kowalski and Paul Smith.
Paul Smith, yeah. The most basic name in the world.
Bro, but could he play, man?
Yeah.
Jesus. Like, he's
off a plus one?
Plus two, I think.
Yeah.
But he did things with a golf club that I'm just sitting there going, and he's not even good.
In comparison.
Yeah, like that's what I mean. Like, that's why when we first thought of this, we thought all these pros doing these videos, no one can do what they do, man.
Yeah.
Like, even Paul can't do what they were doing.
Yeah,
and Paul, we're looking at him going, what the hell?
It was weird for me to see, I guess, yeah, outside of basketball, golf is probably the only sport I've ever really taken somewhat seriously.
Mm.
And I understand the aspects of basketball. Like, if I see somebody have a shot or do a move, whatever, I can be like, okay, I can see how they've done that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
There's nothing he did where I was like, I can see how he did that.
Dude, when he pulled the hybrid out, like, general rule
for
golfers out there, when you're about 3 to 4 feet, maybe 4 meters off the green, you pull out either a chip or a putter.
No, you should just putt it.
He was the first dude I ever saw that pulled out a hybrid.
Yeah.
And I remember bumping you. We were in the cart and I'm just going,
he's about to five putt this.
I was like, what the hell is he doing? Like, why is he getting a hybrid out? And he put it.
I think he ended up within like half a foot or a foot.
And I've just gone, what an asshole.
Yeah.
Like, what the hell, man? Like, this doesn't make sense. And that's why
we beat him.
Yeah. But anyway, like, we ended up winning, and our prize was a free trip back. So we then went again in April.
And these little bad boys. So we won day one, we won day three, and that's our overall championship. They're worth about 1.2 mil each.
Easy.
In Bali.
Easy. But it's funny because the lady that did these, the Swarovski crystals, she still likes and follows all our stuff and actually messaged us saying if we want a golf club with the stuff on it.
You never told me that.
That she's got one. Yeah, yeah. And I was just like,
yes, please.
I was like, oh, man, like, yeah, 100%. Yeah. The one that we should have got to keep anyway.
Yeah, I don't even know if we got our name on that.
Yeah, I don't know. Anyway, so we ended up winning. We got that free trip back.
And I will never get tired of saying it, literal world champions.
Yeah, yeah, 100%.
I don't care that it's not under the umbrella of PGA or whatever governing body people are, because I've had some friends go, oh, yeah, but it's not like an official world thing. I was like, no, we played against people from all around the world.
There were 30,000 participants around the world.
And we won it.
Yeah.
which is why I don't care that they didn't laugh when I said we're better than them in my acceptance speech.
Dude, I don't know how you – I was embarrassed for you.
Because I don't care, man. It was funny to me.
So for those people who don't know, when we won, you get up in front of everyone, you get your trophy, and this idiot decides to go, yeah, thanks for everything, guys, blah, 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 but look, you know, we're better than you,
and we know it.
We know it.
Like, I referred to myself as
Tiger Woods and me as Rory McIlroy. I think no one laughed.
I think also because, like, I mean, obviously I don't care.
We're never going to see them again, right?
Well, even if we did, there's very little in this life I take seriously. I genuinely almost felt like us winning that was a joke. Like, it still didn't seem real.
Yeah, yeah.
Even though I was holding the trophy, we had our names on it or whatever, I was like, this isn't real. Like, I can't take this moment seriously because it's not happening. Like, I was standing there before they announced it. Even the other teams, after we had said what we had hit for the day, and obviously they'd had time to watch us come in and finish the last hole with the boys.
Yeah.
I remember speaking to Ash from South Africa, and he was like, oh, so how'd your boys go? And I was like, dude, I played out my skin today.
How did he say it?
How'd you boys play today? I was like, bro. As it may be, we played so well, man. We played out the fucking minds. Ernie Els would be so proud of us right now.
Ernie Els, the white South African.
Yeah, but he's like the greatest South African goal forever.
Hell yeah.
I remember him saying, oh, we know what everybody else hit. Like, you guys have got it.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, hopefully.
Yeah, shut up.
But it'd be cool to place because we had done well for the days that we had played. And I was like, it'd be cool to like get in the top three. And he was like, no, you got it. And when he said our names, I was still shocked.
Yeah,
like,
100%.
When he called us up, I was like, nah, whatever.
Yeah, whatever.
Like, shut up, idiot.
Yeah, and then when you got up there, you didn't think that. You were like, no, I'm going to rub it in everyone's
face.
Once
I'm in the spotlight, that's my time.
Bro, man.
That's my comfort.
You are on another level. Spot. So, look, every episode, we're going to do something a little bit different. And we want to wrap this up with a couple of what I call the front nine and the back nine. Mm-hmm. Right? So the front nine, look, they're going to be a little bit more, I guess, hard-hitting questions, ones that you have to answer, ones that we can discuss. The back nine is going to be quick fire, and I want you to just quickly, you have
to
answer.
Whatever comes to my mind.
Whatever comes to your mind, but you got to choose between the two, okay. All right?
Oh, and, is it a would you rather?
I'm not even going to say would you rather. I'm just going to name two things, and you just got to tell me.
Yeah, no, fair enough.
And then, you know what? The viewers out there can decide whether you're nuts or not, all right? Or whether they want to deal with you.
Yeah,
all right?
No, they do.
It's not bad either. It's just, you know. All right, so look, first question for the front nine, all right? What is your favorite golf movie?
It depends because as a comedian, I can't go past Happy Gilmore. It's one of the most iconic movies out, regardless of golf.
Rest in
everybody
peace,
Chubbs
Peterson
yeah.
too, man.
Yeah, like everybody knows it. There's so many quotes from it. You can't walk on a golf course without hearing somebody reference it.
Can you give
some
me a reference?
Way, shape, or form. Well, I did it on Sunday. You went to grab my bag. It's like, where you going with those gloves, bud? And you actually kind of backed away because you weren't paying attention, which was, I thought was perfect comedic timing on my part.
Well, I am white, right? Yeah, exactly. Black dude coming at me. I was like, damn, what?
You know, things like go home. You too good for your home?
Yeah, yeah.
And I think that's in our opening video
anyway.
It is,
100%.
Which is dope. If I'm going to have to –
come on, man.
A movie that I could watch over and over and over and over again is The Legend of Bagger Vance.
Yep, okay.
Absolute killer movie.
Okay, I'll take that. What's a superstition that you have that people may find weird, crazy, nasty?
I don't know if it would be weird or crazy or anything, but if I play – and I guess it transferred from basketball to poker to golf. If I played well in any aspect, like if I played a good game in basketball,
yep.
I wouldn't wash any sweatbands, no headbands, no nothing. I don't care how it smells.
Bro.
I'm playing it into the next game, but I won't play it for the game after, even if I have a good second game. So I only ever repeat it once.
Oh, okay.
Let's say hypothetically, because it's never happened. Let's say I scored 30 points three games in a row, right? I would wear.
When did you ever do that?
I said hypothetically.
Oh, hypothetically.
Bitch.
Okay, sorry. My
Shut
bad.
Up. I said we know I'd never do it. Listen to me. So if I drop 30, I would wear the same armbands in the next game.
Yeah.
If I drop 30 again, I'm still washing them for the next game.
Okay.
I could only ever repeat once. I can't do it twice in a row. I don't know why.
Oh, you nasty.
Yeah. If I play a good round in golf, I will wear the exact same golf glove.
Oh, okay.
I'll wear the exact same golf hat.
I think you're about to say underpants, man.
I don't wear underpants.
You don't wear pants.
But I'll rock the same outfit.
That's why no one plays with us,
yeah,
bro.
Yeah, I know. Well, when they say swing your three-wood, I was like, all right, I don't want to destroy the golf course. That's a bigger divot than you're willing to repair. But, yeah, it's just I always repeat the same outfit as much as possible one more time.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. When was the last time you cried from something that wasn't directly related to
Sunday.
You?
Yesterday.
What? Okay. Do you want to go into it or not?
Oh, dude. Like, so I probably for the last 3, 4, 5 years, I've been practicing, like, a lot of gratitude and stuff like that. So this weekend was, like, a big, busy weekend for me. Mm. Had all the fringe stuff. I had a boat party on Saturday, then had more fringe stuff. Sunday we played golf, and
that's why
the whole culmination of that weekend of getting to spend time with the closest people in my life, the people I care about the most. I hadn't seen a bunch of people in that boat party for almost a year. Mm. So just to kind of reconnect with them and be able to do things that I love, like playing golf, hanging out with you, just laughing all the time, doing comedy. I sat on my balcony, and I do it quite often, and I'll just listen to, like, instrumental music and stuff.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I'll just cry, like, out of pure happiness. It just breaks out.
Can I just say, I'm just picturing your neighbours sitting there watching you.
I have neighbours on the other side, on the other balcony, a lovely Indian couple, and they were sitting out there just talking, but I'd be facing away from them, so I'm looking at the river or whatever. If I turn around, they would have just seen me like, look, I don't make that noise.
Jason, are you okay?
Yeah. Don't worry, auntie. I'm good. Thank you very much. Just the sniffles.
So what is one superpower you want and why?
Since I was a kid, ultimate strength, like the Hulk. The angrier I get, the stronger I get.
Cool. What is one world that you want to live in? And when I say this, I mean Harry Potter, Matrix, Lord of the Rings. Right. Like, what kind of world would you want to live in?
Before I answer that, I'm going to give a shout out to T, because I feel like that idea might have come from him.
Nope.
Or did you not listen to the podcast?
Nope.
All right. Okay, cool. Well, shout out to T, because it was a dope idea anyway.
Was it? Okay. Yeah, my bad.
Marvel Universe, 100%.
Ooh, okay.
Like, I mean,
so much can go wrong in that.
So much can go wrong in everything. Look at Harry Potter.
Dude
lost to a snake face.
Whatever. All right.
No, but Marvel Universe, just purely because I love the idea of mutants and the ability to have more powers than a normal human. So.
Okay.
Dragon Ball Z.
Well, wow. Now you're just pushing the pen.
Yeah.
All right. If you had $1 million and you were forced to buy one item, you had to buy the one item.
And it would cost $1 million?
It's not an investment. It's just an item.
But it costs $1 million?
Up to $1 million.
Up to $1 million.
Yeah,
okay.
So you had $1 million, you could buy anything you want. What is it? I feel like I already know what it is, but
up to $1 million, but it can't be like 1,000 pairs of shoes. It can only be one individual thing.
One item.
Okay.
You don't listen very well.
One item.
Oh man, you drop. I could have sworn that I knew it right away what you were gonna pick. We literally drove in it.
Nah, it wouldn't be that. Nah. Because it's also not worth, it's worth more than $1 million.
Is it?
Yeah. G-Wagon's worth more than a mil.
Damn, are you serious?
Yeah. Dude, there's a waiting list on them for almost a decade.
Yeah, I've got one on order, but I didn't think it was $1 million.
Yeah, no, you've been waiting a while. within $1 million, I would probably buy, shit, I don't know, man. I actually have no idea.
Okay, that's fine. Hey, if you don't have an idea, that's fine.
I know what I would do.
Here we go.
I would buy $1 million chip and I would put it on zero. At the casino.
You're an idiot.
Because it pays 36 to 1. And if it lands on it, bam, I got $36 million. If it doesn't, I'm in the same position I was before.
Yeah, fair enough. Hey, that's all right. All right. Now, back nine. All right. Mm. So we finished front nine.
Yep.
Even though I didn't ask nine questions, because some of them here, I was just like, we got to speed this up. Trump or Biden?
Trump.
Ooh, Barracuda. winter or summer?
Summer.
Sea or land?
Land.
Asia or Europe?
Or Europe.
Football or soccer?
Is that AFL football?
Yeah, I'm not giving you anything. Football or soccer. Okay.
Oh, no, in terms of like what I call it.
I don't know. You just got to answer.
Oh, well, it depends in the context.
Just give me an answer. Football or soccer? Three.
Football.
Two, cool.
I hate soccer.
Samsung or Apple?
Apple.
Loser. Xbox or PlayStation?
PlayStation.
Happy Gilmore or Billy Madison?
Happy Gilmore.
Jordan or LeBron?
Jordan.
Interesting. All right. Why? We can't even get into Jordan LeBron. That'll take us a whole other podcast.
Oh, I can tell you why Jordan, though.
Why?
Just because he went into the league the same year I was born.
Oh, fair enough. Yeah. Hey, me too.
Yeah.
Hey, we're the same age.
Did you not know that?
No, I'm joking, man. I'm
sorry. Do you know who Michael, Jeffrey, James, Jehovah Witness Jordan is?
You know who you're talking
to. You have no idea who Michael Jordan is. I don't even know if you know basketball, man. Bro.
Oh, well, look, that's all we have time for right now. But it's been a pleasure to sit down with you, talk a little bit more.
Likewise,
all
brother. Right.
Championship rings on three.
One, two, three.
But look, thank you to everyone who tuned in to listen to us.
Yeah, appreciate you tuning in for the first episode. Hopefully you guys enjoyed it and want to stick around for the next ones that are coming up.
So the next episode, we're going to be looking at stereotypes within golf, life, everything in general.
Love it.
So, yeah, thanks for listening to our first ever Out the Bunker podcast. I'm your host, DT.
I'm Jase. This is Top Deck Golf. We're better than you, and we know it.
She had to go there. Peace out, everyone.
Catch ya. What's cracking, guys? Jase from Top Deck Golf here. Just a reminder to like, subscribe, comment on this podcast. Any ideas or questions you want us to throw out on the next episode, make sure you hit all of your alerts when you're on YouTube so you see the next episodes. And always follow, love, peace out.